Okay, this is going to be Chapter 18, the Urinary System, Part 2. And in this section, we're going to talk about the control of kidney function. Normal kidney function depends on the glomerular filtration rate, and this is accomplished in three ways. Local autonomic adjustments in the glomerular pressures. Activities of the sympathetic nervous system. This is going to be adrenaline gland on top of your kidney. And through the effects of various hormones, and we've already talked about two of them. We're going to talk about another one in here, which is called renin, aldosterone, ADH, in the distal convoluted tubule. Local regulation of kidney function. Local autonomic changes in the diameters of the afferent and efferent materials, and this keeps the glomerular filtration rates relatively constant. So this thing continuously, if it isn't getting the appropriate amount of pressure, is gauging the afferent, or changing the afferent and the efferent arterioles in size. Sympathetic activation and kidney function. Sympathetic tone works to shunt blood away from the kidneys, and this reduces glomerular filtration rates and decreases urinary output. One of the things that we get with adrenaline, which is coming from the adrenal medulla, epinephrine and norepinephrine, is we get a constriction of vessels, which will reduce afferent blood supply. It's designed to shunt blood towards the core so that the core body blood pressure will go up. But sometimes what occurs is it decreases the amount of pressure that's actually going to the kidneys and will reduce glomerular filtration rate and urinary output. Hormonal control of kidney functions. The renin-angiotensin system. Renin converts angiotensinogen, and this has got both things in it, to angiotensin 1. And ACE converts angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2. Now, this has to travel all the way around the body. The ACE is located in your lungs. So as angiotensin 1 goes through the capillary alveolar membranes of your lungs, it's converted into angiotensin 2. Angiotensin 2 pretty much is a vasoconstrictor. So it takes vessels like this, and it turns them into vessels like this. Angiotensin 2 in the capillary beds causes vasoconstriction in the nephron, constricts the efferent arterioles, and elevates the glomerular pressures and the filtration rates. CNS in the central nervous system releases antidiuretic hormone, which stimulates reabsorption of water and sodium, and this is in the distal convoluted tubule. And pretty much this also increases thirst. Adrenaline gland stimulates the secretion of aldosterone by the adrenaline cortex. Dramatic increase in systemic blood pressure occurs. Alright, this is a quick picture. This is going to go in kind of a circular fashion. So, this is homeostasis as normal. Decreased blood flow to the kidneys. Decreased filtration pressure. Decreased filtrate and urine production. The juxtaculomedullary apparatus secretes renin, taking angiotensinogen to angiotensin 1 to angiotensin 2. ACE was in there in the lungs. Angiotensin 2 causes a constriction of the efferent arterioles. It also does several things. If we'll notice, it's kind of branched out here. Increases aldosterone secretion from the adrenaline glands. This produces sodium retention. Water follows sodium. In the CNS, increased stimulation of the thirst centers, increased antidiuretic hormone production, increased sympathetic motor tone. So all of this increases fluid consumption, fluid retention, constriction of venous reservoirs, increased cardiac output from the sympathetic tone, and increased peripheral vasoconstriction. These areas here give us an increased blood volume. And this increased systemic pressure from the harder, faster, stronger, and the constriction of vessels. Hopefully all of this will restore homeostasis and increase glomerular pressure. urine transport, storage, and elimination, the ureters and the urinary bladder, kidney stones, the urethra, clinical note or urinary tract infections, the micturition reflex and urination, and then clinical note over incontinence. Urine transport, storage, and elimination. Filtrate modification and urine production end when the fluid enters the renal pelvis. And we talked about this. This is whenever it forms urine. We can't get to it anymore. The ureters and the urinary bladder. Ureters, paramuscular tubes that conduct urine from the kidneys to the urinary bladder. Ureteral opening, slits like ureteral openings prevent backflow. And these are kind of a one-way valve. Urinary bladder, hollow muscular organ that stores the urine. Internal urethral sphincter, more terms here, provides involuntary control over the discharge of urine from the bladder. And this would be the internal one, not the external one. And we come to the clinical note on kidney stones. And these things are painful. One, point that out. They're mainly calcium salts, calcium phosphate, and calcium oxalate. The pretty much treatment of these, whenever we treat patients with these, are IV fluids to put more glomerular filtration pressure so that we can hopefully push them down the ureters into the urinary bladder and then out the urethra. If they're too large, then we'll have to bust them up. And then pain meds for the movement. Whenever it's moving in the ureter, it is very, very painful. These were too large to pass. These can cause kidney failure and the stopping of the production of urine. And a few, these are the kidney stones, the renal calculi. The urethra. Urethra extends from the neck of the urinary bladder to the exterior of the body. External urethral sphincter. It's a sphincter and consists of skeletal muscle fibers, and contractions are under voluntary control. And a quick clinical note over urinary tract infections. Most of them are bacterial infections of the urinary tract. The urinary tract is kind of set up, though, to where it resists the setup of bacteria. pH is kind of acidic, where bacteria just cannot generally set up in there. 1813, figure 1813 in your book. These are problems of the conducting system and disorders of the urinary system in general. Kidney problems, and we'll talk about these. Nephrolithiasis in the ureters, urinary bladder cystitis and bladder cancer. In the urethra, urinary obstruction, urethritis, or urinary tract infection, all can cause problems of the conducting system. In kidney problems, metabolic and endocrine disorders, insipidus, which is an ADH problem, diabetes mellitus, which you have large sugar molecules that essentially beat up the nephron, hypoaldosteronism, too much aldosterone or not enough aldosterone, and then dehydration, cardiovascular disorders, shock, low perfusion to the kidneys, acute stress, increased levels of glucocorticoids and stress hormones, which are mineralocorticoids as well, atherosclerosis, decreased lumen of the actual vessels going to the kidneys, acute kidney failure, renal failure, inherited disorders, polycystic kidney disease, infection and inflammation. We can get nephritis, pellitus, polynephritis, or glomerular nephritis. This would be inflammation of the glomerulus. A lot of things can go wrong. Micturition reflex and urination. Urination, expulsion of urine from the bladder. Micturition means also urination. Micturition reflex or urination reflex. Stretch receptors in the bladder stretch when the bladder fills with urine. And this kind of gives us a feedback system. So one here, sensory fibers in the pelvic nerve and stretch receptors are stimulated. This stimulates our spinal nerve. In the spinal cord. 2A, parasympathetic preganglion motor neuron, and this is going to kind of give us an efferent. This will be up here, we'll talk about this in a second. The stimulus and ascent, north, interneuron relays a sensation to the thalamus. Postganglionic neuron in the intramural ganglion stimulates detrusor muscle contraction, in 3B after this. Projection fibers from the thalamus deliver sensation to the cerebral cortex. I have to pee. And then 4, voluntary relaxation of the external urethral sphincter causes relaxation of the internal urethral sphincter as well. And urine comes out. Clinical note of incontinence. Trauma to the internal or external urethral sphincter can cause incontinence. And then CNS damage, obviously. Nerve supply to the bladder or external sphincter. Fluid and electrolyte acid-base balance. Fluid and electrolyte balance, acid-base balance, and then disturbances of the acid-base balance. Fluid and electrolytes, acid-base balance, we're going to talk about extracellular fluid, intracellular fluid, fluid balance, electrolyte balance, and then acid-base balance. A few terms here. Fluid balance, the amount of water you gain is equal to the amount of water you lose in an environment, kind of a balancing act, loss and gain. Electrolyte balance, ions released through the dissociation of inorganic compounds. Fluid shift, the movement between extracellular fluid and intracellular fluid. And this is where we're going to get that semipermeable membrane that we get stuff moving in both directions on all the time. And all it's really trying to do is just maintain an equal balance on both sides of that membrane. Figure 18-15 in your book, intracellular fluid is about 60%. Interstitial fluid, and this is going to be outside of the cell. This would also encompass the extracellular fluid, which is the other 40%. We have interstitial fluid, plasma, fluid in the connective tissues, and then minor components of this are going to be lymph, cerebrospinal fluid, synovial fluid in the joints, serous fluid in the tissues, aqueous humor, eyeball, endolymph, and perilymph from the lymphatics. Acid-base balance. The production of hydrogen ions is equal to their loss. And we maintain an acid-base balance based on the amount of hydrogen ion that we have in our body. 7.35 to 7.45 is the pH we should try to maintain. If we're off by one point in either direction, it is life-threatening. We have three buffer systems that primarily do this, and please remember these. This is going to need to go into long-term memory. Bicarbonate buffer system. In the bicarbonate buffer system is your primary buffer. It works off of your respiratory drive. It interacts with it and gives the ability to move hydrogen ions out quite quickly. Primary buffer system of the body works in the extracellular fluid. We have the protein buffer system. Regulates pH in the extracellular fluid and the intracellular fluid as well. So this works inside the cell and outside the cell on this one. Phosphate buffer system assists the bicarbonate buffer system, and this is going to be assisting. Now, both of these, protein and phosphate, move very slow, so we can't think about any kind of drastic changes that will occur in minutes. The bicarbonate buffer system, however, has the ability to work within minutes. Respiratory compensation. Change in respiratory rate to help stabilize the pH of the extracellular fluid. And then renal compensation, change in hydrogen ion absorption or secretion depending on the overall acid-base balance of the body. Clinical note here, disturbances of acid-base, and we're going to talk about these. Let's talk about the respiratory side first, and I'm going to go ahead and blink the screen at this point. So, CO2, let's talk about that. So if we have an abundance of CO2, like we are not breathing well or we are in a respiratory arrest and we have CO2 levels that rise, very simply, CO2 levels will very quickly, if we have CO2 and water, which does our body have enough water? Yes, it does. It has a plenty of water. We will make H2CO3. Now, for any of y'all that's wondering what that is carbonic acid. So let me break this down very simply. If you have an abundance of CO2, you have a gigantic building block, the development of carbonic acid. our body has something on the red blood cell called carbonic anhydrase. And carbonic anhydrase will very quickly, and this is a reversible reaction, break H2CO3 down to water and CO2. And we'll reverse it again. We'll put water and CO2 together to form carbonic acid. This is a major acid of our system. Now, very simply, let me clear this off here. So CO2 retention will increase our acid levels. All right, so we ask three things whenever we're trying to determine someone's acid base. First question we ask, does it have anything to do, what's the pH? And we should be at 7.35 to 7.45. Two, does it have anything to do with CO2? Now, again, if we have a high CO2 level, we're going to be making acids. If we have a low CO2 level, we're not going to have enough components to make an acid. So our CO2 level should be 35 to 45. And number three, what is their bicarb level? And this is the bicarbonate buffer system. Very simply, 22 to 26. Now, if this is low, then they don't have enough base to correct an acid-base derangement. If it's high, then they could be in a metabolic alkalosis. All right, so those are the three questions we're going to ask. One, what's the pH? Because this is going to say acidosis or alkalosis. Two, does it have anything to do with CO2? This is going to tell us if it's respiratory or not. And then three, does it have anything to do with bicarb, or what's our bicarbonate level? If this is low, this is 7.2, and we have a bicarbonate level of 16, it is a metabolic acidosis. All right, so let's do some of these in order here so we can start seeing a pattern. Okay, respiratory acidosis, let's start with that one. This patient's pH is 7.25. Their CO2 levels is 65. And their bicarb is 24. They're in some sort of acidosis. Question one. Question two, this should be 35 to 45. They have more than an abundance of CO2. They can make carbonic acid very easily. So I'm pretty sure this is going to be respiratory acidosis. I'll get it here in a second. There we go. Okay. Respiratory alkalosis. Their pH is 7.65. Their CO2 is 12. Their bicarb is 25. Step one, are they acidic or alkalotic? They're in some sort of alkalosis. Step two, do they have ample amounts of CO2 or is it low? So very simply, this person does not have enough base supply to make carbonic acid. So this is going to be respiratory alkalosis. On the flip side of this, on this gas right here, the oxygen level should look the same. 200, if we have them on changed atmospheric conditions, like we have an ET tube in place. This would be what our ABGs turn out to be. Very simply, if we put, this is only one piece of pie, as we put more oxygen in it, we are going to displace the rest of the gases in this piece of pie. I got two more to do. Okay, metabolic acidosis. pH on this person is 7.1. There's CO2. In this case here, we're going to say that it's normal. So it's 30. 6, my apologies. I had DKA in my head for some reason. I'll explain that here in just a second. So it's 36. O2 of 100. Bicarb. 18. Step 1. They're in some sort of acidosis. Does it have anything to do with CO2? It's kind of normal. Oxygen, it's given us a good picture on the balancing act there. Why is our bicarb so low? So our body has used its primary buffer system, and it has nothing to do with CO2, so it's a metabolic. The definition of a metabolic acidosis is a third party. Acidosis has nothing to do with carbonic acid, essentially. So, ketotic acid, pyruvic acid, lactic acid, any other kind of acid besides carbonic acid. All right, one more. pH 7.85, CO2 at 40, O2 98, bicarb. Say it's even high. So, step 1. Are they acidic or alkaline? They're in alkalosis. Have anything to do with CO2? What's my bicarb look like? It's high. Metabolic alkalosis. Okay, these teeter-totters here on 18-17, that pH and CO2 levels are directly relationship with one another. If the CO2 rises, then the pH falls. If the PCO2 falls, then the pH rises. And this is going to be alkalotic. This is going to be acidic. Age in the urinary system, and then renal trauma in the section. So, aging in the urinary system, we get a decline in the functional nephrons, one. We get a reduction of glomerular filtration rate. We get a reduced sensitivity to antidiuretic hormone and aldosterone. A problem with the micturition reflex, or peeing reflex. Gradual decrease in total body water content. And net loss of mineral content. and an increased incident of disorders that would affect major symptoms. Examples of this are going to be atherosclerosis, heart failure, things like this. Clinical note here, as far as renal trauma, a good thing to give somebody renal trauma is going to be a gunshot wound. A gunshot wound causes, as the bullet enters into the tissue, whenever this bullet enters in there, it will cause a cavitation wave that is larger than the actual bullet track. Now, with that said, if the kidneys become damaged, that could cause direct renal trauma from a cavitation wave of the bullet path. This is his belly button. This went straight through since about that lower rib. It's where the kidneys are located. That would be in a bad spot. Integration with other systems, please look over these and take a look at what all systems that it integrates with. Quick overview of terms to know. Acidosis, that would be a lowering pH or high hydrogen ion concentration. Aldosterone, this is going to control sodium and water content. Alkalosis, the pH is too high, greater than 7.45. Angiotensin II, vasoconstriction, comes from angiotensinogen and the renin system. Buffer system, there are three of them we talked about. Bicarbonate, protein, and phosphate buffer systems. Filtrate, this would be the initial formation of urine in the glomerulus. Glomerular filtration rate, this would be the amount of filtration rate that was initiated in the proximal convoluted tubule by the glomerulus. Glomerulus, where all the action happens. Fenestrations from the capillary pores give us an initial filtrate in the proximal convoluted tubule. Juxtaguloglomerular apparatus, and this is going to be the one that's farther down in the cones, also the one that controls renin. Kidney, that's what we've been talking about this entire chapter. Loop of Henle, we have a descending and an ascending. Descending is permeable to water, ascending is not, but we do move sodium and chloride out of the ascending loop. Micturition or urination, nephron, which is the functional unit of the kidney, peritubular capillaries, and these are going to be all the little capillaries on the outsides of the tubule, renin, which is an enzymatic breakdown of angiotensinogen into angiotensin 1. ACE converts it in the lungs to angiotensin 2, and we get vasoconstriction. Ureters, urine collecting ducts that are outside of the kidneys and move the urine to the bladder. Urinary bladder houses there for a temporary time, and then urine itself. This ends part two. If you have any questions, feel free to contact me. My name is Roy Smith, 405-219-7613, or smithr@nmso.net. Thank you.